Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming?
Hello, everybody, and a happy 4th of July to everybody in the United States of America. This is the only kind of American accent I can do, so I'm going to be doing it the whole drive. I hope you enjoy it. My name's James. On camera, we got Brian. With his American thumb. That's a great American thumb you got there, Brian. Well done. It's very nice. Over there, we got some hippopotamus, we got some buffaloes, and we got some elephants, and some waterbuckers. Well, that's enough of that. Right, welcome to it, everybody. We're on to the sunset safari on this, the 4th of July, 2016. And, of course, in America, celebrating the independence from Great Britain circa 1776. That is a very, very long time ago. Anyway, I hope you're having a wonderful family holiday there in the United States, and in honour of your holiday, we are going to be doing a small competition between Jamie and I. It's called a mammal race. Now, we have got the long lens, so I'm hoping we're going to be able to win it. We're also going to do a bird race. So, we've had hippopotamus, we've had waterbuck, we've had elephant, we've had buffalo, and over there, crossing over at the far side there, we've got some kudu. So we're on to five mammals already. So that's pretty good going. Please do talk to us. You're on a live safari if you're wondering what on earth you're looking at here. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. Jamie Patterson is going to be presenting from the other vehicle. She's being filmed by the lovely, luscious brunette locks of David Eastor, and in the final control, the terrifying figure of Kirsten McLennan-Smith, ably assisted by the guns of Louise Pavid. Welcome to the 4th of July special. Here we go. Our plan this afternoon is going to be to head to Cheetah Plains, but I think we're actually going to sit here for a little while because there's quite an array of animals going on here. Now, this particular waterhole is going to become a serious focal point over the next little while. As we've discussed, there is a serious amount of dry... that's a terrible way of putting it. We've had a very dry rainy season. We're into the middle of now our dry season, which is going to be drier than normal because of the poor rainy season preceding it. So this little pumped waterhole is going to become a focal point. For a hippo to be here now is very unusual. In fact, I'm going to sneak forward so that we can get a better view of that hippo. He's just going into the water there. This is not an ideal hippo territory by any stretch, and he was in that water until those elephants chased him out of it. They were deeply unimpressed to find someone else in the water. The buffalo bulls are going to spend a lot of time around here because this is where they like to be. They must have water if they're going to cope with the very poor quality of the forage. And as long as there is poor quality, or as long as there is some water, they can cope with just about the worst kinds of forage there is. But if the water starts to run out, then those buffalo start to struggle. Beautiful afternoon, very silent afternoon. And that's because, well, it's the middle of the afternoon and everything's in the midday lull. Right, Brian, we've got first bird over there, Birchall starling on the ground. Let's hit that one. There we go. And now, Brian, I'm going to ask you to do a zip pan. Whip pan, sorry, to a red-billed hornbill. Kirsten, you have to keep tally, right? I don't have to count these, correct? Eating termites. Red-billed hornbill eating termites out of, I don't know. Looks like it must be a ground-dwelling termite, perhaps Odontotermes. Then we've got red-billed oxpecker on top of the buffalo bull over there. I really am asking you to do a lot of whipping around, Brian. There it is. It's on that beefalo there. And we luckily have the long lens. This is, of course, cheating. And we will, just to remind you, we do have a fireside chat for 15 minutes at the end of this drive, 4th of July special and all that. And then, Brian, to the left of that, we've got a Natal Franklin on the ground, if I'm not mistaken. Keep going. Underneath, fossicking about in those branches, that pile of dead sticks. Keep going left. You got him. There we are. Yes, Natal Franklin. We're doing okay, everybody. We're doing okay. I don't suppose bird calls count, do they? I could give you Oriole, but I don't think we can count them. Kirsten says, absolutely not. Don't be ridiculous, you imbecile. Sorry, Kirsten. All right, let's go across to Jamie for the next 3.5 seconds so that she can find something also for you to look at. But come back quickly because I don't want to lose this competition.
Well, now that James has established himself a rather hearty lead in our mammal and bird competition, I have seen absolutely nothing on my way to Arethusa. But hello, my name is Jamie, and this afternoon I have Dave on camera with me. Dave, there's a bird. There's a bird, Dave. Dave, it's a shagra. They never sit still, Dave. Oh, no. Where's it gone, Dave? There it is. It is hopping about in the base of all of those dead leaves. Oh, and I can hear a go-away bird calling. You've got it. Well done. There is a go-away bird, everybody. Tick that one off our list. Fantastic. That's one down. Couple of hundreds to go. Well, they're all go-away birds. That's terribly disappointing. Where's the chagra gone? That definitely counts as well. We're off to a dramatic start with our go-away birds. I don't want to lose this competition. James is on 9. I am on 2. I'm not even sure that the chagra really counts. But we're on 2. Are we going to take it? I don't even think we should take that one, Dave. Kirsty's accepted it, and Kirsty, of course, is the adjudicator of all things, since she is the director, so we've accepted that one. We're now on 2, James is on 9, let us not delay, let us carry on driving. And we are off on our live safari. Ooh. Now, you see, Wendy's clutch isn't right. Anyway. No, now it's stuck. It's stuck in... Oh, no, this doesn't bode well at all for our competition... The gear is stuck. Dave, just for some evidence, my foot is in on the clutch, right? Try that again. It's hydraulic. We just need to get the pressure up. There we go. Ah, voila. Okay. Onwards, but not too far in case we have to be towed home. I do know what the problem with Wendy's clutch is, by the way, and Steph is on his way to rescue us with a spare part. And since we're driving along and having this very special competition, just to wish all of our viewers a very happy 4th of July, and of course, since Wild Earth is a global community, that goes for the viewers watching in the States, as well as our many viewers in the Philippines, who celebrate Republic Day on the 4th of July to celebrate their independence from the year 1946. I'll leave you to do the rest of the history reading yourselves. And then, of course, our multiple viewers in Rwanda, who celebrate Liberation Day on the 4th of July, in order to celebrate their liberation around the time of 1994. So a very special day for lots of members of the various Wild Earth community and viewers. Right, Drongo! Drongo, there's a Drongo! Oh, there's the Drongo. Fantastic. Tick number 3. Dave, there's more there. There's more there, Dave. Oh, no, Dave. Those were some female weavers that just fluttered off into the distance. Do we count them? Maybe not. We'll settle for 3. Oh, Kirsty's counting them as well. I think Kirsty might be on my side. And of course, we have the added advantage of the lovely Chelsea Green on the back of the vehicle as well. So, Chelsea, earn your keep. Very soft little voice coming from the back saying, I will. Now, let us see what we can find. Oh, no. James's lead is building. James has found something else. Let's go and find out what it is.
Does it move? Everybody, there was a black-collared barber there, of course, but I've been sabotaged by girl power. The link didn't come fast enough. You see, they knew I had a bird, and so they didn't link to me, because they knew. Black-collared barber, it goes, too puddly, too puddly, too puddly, too puddly, too puddly, too puddly, too puddly. But it ain't going too puddly nothing now, is it?
No.
No. It's a disaster. Now, Brian, I wanted to ask you, is it okay if I wear these because they're American?
I don't think they look that bad.
Don't you?
No.
Yes, okay.
Marvellous.
No, I don't think I'll wear them. We're going to roll gently down this hill. There. There it is. It's in that tree there. I've spotted it, Brian. Can you see it? No, that's a bush. Go to the left. Did you see it there?
No.
I can't see it anymore. It's in that bush, I promise you, everybody. It doesn't count if we don't see it. There it goes, it's flown away! Did you see it fly? Did you see where it landed? Shall I stop? Back? Huh? Stall? No. Never mind, everybody. Never mind. We'll try and find something else. So we're on nine creatures, are we? Nine creatures, Brian. Avian and mammalian. That would have been number 10 if girl power hadn't gotten our way, sabotaged us. Sisters doing it for themselves, etc., etc. Marisha in Texas, you want to know what the reward is for the team that wins. Marisha, the reward is the satisfaction of knowing that you have won, A, and B, you get an extra tot of apple juice this evening around the fire. Fine, would you like an extra tot of apple juice this evening?
Oh, yes, please.
Yes, please. You see.
And bragging rights.
And bragging rights, of course. What have you spotted? I thought Brian had spotted something, everybody.
I'm too excited.
At the thought of that extra tot of apple juice. Yes, I know what you mean. It makes me want to drive very quickly. Of course, one mustn't drive very quickly if one wants to spot anything. Ah, Crested Franklin, on the road, number 10. Here we are. Right, let's move on. Slender mongoose. I saw it, doesn't count. See if you can see that. No, we're not linking to anybody, Kirsten. We're staying right with us. There's a slender mongoose in here. Kirsten's going to struggle to get a link. She's going to have to crash cut away from me. You may just suddenly arrive with Jamie, everyone. Kirsten, I promised there was a slender mongoose in here. No, it's gone. All right, let's go across to Jamie and get an update from her.
And hark, the diversion tactics of one who knows that he is doomed to lose this competition. Because everyone knows the underdog always wins, right? Exactly. And whilst the extra tot of apple juice is most appealing, perhaps the bragging rights are what we are all looking forward to having over each other. Strangely enough, you wouldn't believe this, but there's mongoose! Oh no, don't go away. Okay, sorry, mongoose. Here we go. Now, does that count as four? Or are we really pushing things a little bit now? Even Kirsty's not quite willing to bend the rules quite to that extent on my behalf. So one of my favourite little animals to spot, and I don't want to race off because despite the competition, this is still about learning about the different wonderful animals of the African bush. But just in case it does fly away and I don't really want to lose the competition, Dave, in the far distance on the road, there is a dove. It is wandering about. Down a bit. There we go, on the left. An emerald spotted. Oh, no, almost. Now it's in the right. There we go. Now it's in the centre of the screen, sort of towards the top. It's quite all right. It is very far away. That is an emerald-spotted wood dove. Before it disappears, a bird considered to be of enormous bad luck in the local culture. You're not meant to listen to its entire call or else your house might burn down, which is, of course, not at all true. They're lovely birds and there's absolutely nothing that is bad luck about them. So back to our dwarf mongoose, who haven't been quite so quick at disappearing, having a jolly good groom, and I think probably enjoying the increase in temperature that we have all enjoyed over the last 24 hours. This morning was positively freezing. I was relatively certain that I was going to lose an extremity, but fortunately we've all returned home intact, and the temperature has warmed up beautifully. And I almost wish there were more hours in the day, because I would love to just spend an entire morning or an afternoon with these little chaps and just watch them, just one colony, and get an idea as to what exactly their day-to-day life entails. This, by the way, I think might be the same colony of dwarf mongoose where, if you cast your mind back many months ago, we saw the dwarf mongoose with a very white face. I've never seen him again. It was totally unique. It was with Tebs on camera with me, and it was on Halloween, and he looked like he was wearing little Halloween face paint. Pure white face. It was absolutely incredible. And ever since, every time I come across to Arethusa, I stop and I look to see whether or not he is around. He or she is around. I can hear a woodpecker. Should we go search for the woodpecker? Oh, so many things to see, so little time. Torn between wanting to win this competition and watching the dwarf mongoose. To the airstrip with us. Well, that is where we often find animals. There's a drongo, we've already done that one. A Cape turtle dove. Which I generally make a habit of driving past, to be completely honest, since there are many, many of them to be seen. And they're just, not just your standard dove, but they are the standard dove of this area. But since this is a competition, we shall stop and find you as many things as possible. We are up to 7, Dave. We're catching up on James. Right, so to cheating in China, you were wondering about, I've got to get out of that habit, sorry. You wanted to know whether any of our animals are fitted with GPS trackers. Yes, one in particular, a very famous little leopard called Sindile. He's not so little anymore. And that was because it was very, very unusual circumstances. He caught a domestic dog or a stray dog that had wandered onto the reserve. And as a result, because that dog tested positive for rabies, he was put in quarantine and then released back into the area 8 months later. And due to his age and the fact that this is one of the most unique situations, he's been fitted with a GPS tracker so as to monitor his movements and his success in returning to the wild. The batteries have, I think, since run flat, and we no longer get any updates from Sindile's collar, but it was a marvelous way of learning a bit more about the way in which a leopard adjusts, having been in captivity for 8 months and then released. Other than that, there's the odd collar, so a frequency transmitter or a GPS transmitter on some elephants and some buffalo, almost invariably due to research purposes, or for research purposes, because the act of fitting an animal with a GPS tracker is a relatively invasive one, and it's not something we would want to subject our animals to unless the benefits outweighed the negatives. I want to resist linking, but I can't do that because that would be bad sportsmanship. James has something else.
Yellow-billed hornbill. There we go. There you see, yellow on its bill, ergo, yellow-billed hornbill. Number 11. I think it's eating little cambritum pods, which is quite interesting. I've never seen anything eat those before. They're not normally very frugivorous, these birds, but I suppose they have to be at this time of the year. Otherwise, it's rather quiet out here. Okay, I'm going to pop my head over the edge of Twin Dams here. Damn it. Jamie's got something else now.
Ha ha! I do indeed have something else. Bravo to Dave, who has put us back into the running once again with a lovely family of warthog, one that some of you may be familiar with. They spend a lot of time around the Arethusa airstrip, which is where, of course, where we are headed to. Two sows and their collection of piglets. Now, if I'm not mistaken, I believe these females actually had seven between them at one stage. That number's now down to four. But the four remaining piglets are almost out of the woods in terms of the age that they've reached, or at least the most dangerous time of a young warthog's life. So they often form these little sounders. The females can be related to each other, but are not necessarily. Oh, minor panic. It's okay. Crisis averted. All is well in the world. And they, I have to say, are probably one of my favourite animals to stop and look at. And whenever I see them, I automatically think of Tara Dales, the lovely lady who used to direct our shows at one point. She has since left Wild Earth, but she did absolutely love a good warthog sighting. They were her favourite things to see. Now this is for you, Tara, wherever you may be. Oh dear, James has found another one.
Jeepers, it took them about half an hour to get to us. The squirrels nearly died of old age. There's a squirrel, everybody. Tree squirrel. Hooray. Number 12. I think they're rather splendid little creatures, especially when they knock me up a little peg or two. There we go. Tree squirrel it is. Jamie will no doubt find a leopard now, or something equally impressive. But a leopard's only 1 point. Ha ha. See what else we can find on our way to Cheetah Plains. Maybe a cheetah. There's still only 1 point though. No, you can't do community nest spiders, not going to work. And thank you, safari lover Elaine. You say a big shout out to all the kids in Virginia Beach, Virginia, who watch this show and have watched it and enjoyed sort of some of their class time with us. I agree. Big shout out to all of them. And as Jamie says, to the Rwandans, and they've been through a hell of a time over in the last 20 or so years. So big shout out to them. And I didn't realize it was Philippines Independence Day as well. I don't know the Filipino national anthem, do you, Brian? Are you able to sing it? No.
Yeah, no.
No. I've forgotten it as well. Now, the trick is to find something before Jamie does again. Because I know that once they're on her, you see, Brian, what happens is girl power takes over. And our animals that we find die of old age before they link to us.
It's true.
It is so true. Hello, Gracie, aged 8 in Ohio. You say, whoever finds a cinnamon bun bird gets 1,000,000 points. Well, I agree with that. I haven't seen a cinnamon bun bird for some time, Gracie, but we'll do our best. You say we're going to have fireworks and apple juice? No, we might have apple juice. We're not going to have fireworks, Gracie. We don't have fireworks out here because it makes the animals a little bit scared. So we're not going to make any fireworks out here. But we'll light a fire in honor. Are you having fireworks, Gracie? I hope everybody is having fireworks tonight. Well, quietish fireworks. We know they do make animals a little bit terrified. Brian, this is the only drive I've been on when I've never seen an impala. All right, apparently I need to link back to Jamie now. See you just now.
Look, I found another one. I found another species for our list. In this case, two chaps who I don't think realise they are actually on international internet television. But there you have it. They are included in our... They are included, right, Kirst? It's a species. Nobody specified. Definitely included. Also found a cat. Ha ha, that joke's definitely been made before. But we found a cat. It is currently occupied in sorting things out. Right. We'll move on. We'll find you something a little bit more exciting than human activity. I'm uncertain as to what they are doing on the Arethusa airstrip. But I think it, Oh, I can't change my route at this point. We have to go this way. Otherwise, we're just going back the way we've just come. And apparently, the same species does not count twice. I presume that means for each person, rather than I'm now barred from elephant, waterbuck, and all the other multitude of things that James managed to add to his list. Oh no, it does mean that. Kirsty, what are you doing to me? So James got the hornbills as well. Oh no. I just won't stand for this. We'll have to find a leopard. We could get a grey hornbill. Great. Let's give them a quick wave. Oh dear. What that means is that my clever plan, my cunning plan of coming to the Arethusa airstrip and ticking off all of the species that might be around here has been somewhat sabotaged. Oh, woe is me. James has already ticked off that starling as well. All right. Come on, Dave. We're not giving up that easily. We might just have to do a very rapid circumnavigation of the Arethusa airstrip, which is completely devoid of all life. Uh-oh. Okay, we seem to be okay. We went through a bit of a signal dip there. Roger, in Tampa, you were wondering, as we race along searching for... I hear lapwings. I see a lapwing. James hasn't got one of those yet. There you go. A crowned... No, that's a starling. Sorry. James has got one of those. They're sitting on the mounds of earth over there-ish. There-ish. There we go. I'm sure I saw movement there. Oh, no. There we go. There we go. Fantastic. Right. So we've crossed the crowned lapwing off our list and apparently off James's list as well. Now, as you can see, just while we have a look at how much grass there is, you can see that things are incredibly dry, even here on the open area of the Arethusa airstrip. Roger, in Tampa, no, I have never experienced a drought of this magnitude. Apparently, the last one that is comparable was in 1992. I was 2 years old at the time, so I'm not sure that I'm going to count that as my drought experience. And, in theory, this might actually be the worst drought in about 100 years. So no, I have never experienced a drought as severe as this one, which is both tragic but also educational, because I think we're going to be getting an idea of how incredibly well an ecosystem like this will be able to recover from a situation such as the one we're experiencing. And that, of course, is the joy of Safari Live, because it's not about coming to visit for a limited period, maybe 3 days, 4 days, a week, 2 weeks. You've got the opportunity to watch for months at a time and progress of drought. And before I get too distracted by this competition, we appear to be going through some rocky signal patches. And since that's happening... Oh, no, come on, he can't have Impala too. All right, over to James.
Impala, everybody, and... roller. Flying. It's gone. We missed it. Right, we've got Impala. We're on to 13. I promise you, there's a real girl power problem going on here, everybody. I said, when Jamie got human being, I mean, ridiculous. She got human being. Kirsten came to me. She's got 10 now. She's nearly caught up to you. It's very unfair. Don't you think, Brian?
I do think so.
I feel we're fighting against the odds here.
We are.
We don't care though, do we, Brian? Yeah. Well, there's the roller. It's on the edge of that very large dead marula tree. You see it?
I see it.
Yes. Kirsten, tell Jamie we've got 14. There it is. Lilac-breasted roller. And no amount of girl power is going to take away lilac-breasted roller from us, Brian. Oh, no. Oh, no. Let's move on. Now, they're called rollers. Well, because they roll. They've got this amazing display that they do, normally in the summertime. But I was walking with Herbert yesterday, as I told some of you this morning. And we were going through a couple of Shungun bird names. And that one I did know is Veve. And it's because of the call that it makes. And it's like most of these Shungun words, onomatopoeic. It goes... Such a beautiful bird, such an unattractive call. I knew a girl like that once, Brian. It wasn't splendid at all. Right, next one. Next birdie, next mammal. Hello, Tim in Kansas City. You want to know what our main holidays here are? Well, I suppose the main holiday is the 24th of April. That is our sort of Independence Day, if you like. It's a bit like yours. And I think we call it Freedom Day, and it was the day of the first democratic elections here in 1994. So that's a very important one. Then the 16th of June is called Youth Day, and that's a very important day in our calendar because it commemorates the 1976 Soweto uprisings, where a whole group of students were basically massacred by the apartheid police for protesting against what was a pathetic education system that they were offered. And then I suppose the next one we'd celebrate is the 24th of September. The 24th of September is Heritage Day. And Heritage Day is when we all celebrate our heritage. So if you happen to be of Scottish origin, which I am, then you might celebrate that. Otherwise, if you're a Zulu, you might dress in your Zulu garb. Or if you're a Xhosa, you might do the same. And likewise, if you're an Afrikaner, you might build yourself an ox wagon or something like that. And then I think the next important one, I don't know what they call it anymore, actually. It's the 16th of December. It's a major public holiday. And it is called... Brian, do you remember what it's called? Might be Family Day, I think it's the 26th of December. I don't know, but those are the major holidays that we have here. And there are a number of others, but those are the major ones. Might be Workers' Day, I'm not sure. No, that's in May. Christmas Day is still a major holiday. I mean, you guys have got Thanksgiving. I'll come back to that. Jamie's got a bird.
Look, we found the other species of hornbill, barring, of course, the ground hornbill. It's a grey hornbill, really, really far away and really well hidden behind the leaves. But it counts, because I promise you it's a grey hornbill. Hiding behind the trees. Well done, Dave. Definitely a grey hornbill. There you go. You can see at that point that it is, in fact, a grey hornbill. All right, so that concludes our sort of listing of the smaller hornbill species. Elephant! Ah, doesn't count. And James Richard, you're saying now we just need to tick off the southern ground hornbill. We do. I nearly saw one this morning at Cheetah Plains, and unfortunately I couldn't find it. I could hear it calling, that deep gook-gook-gook-gook sound that they make. Now, southern ground hornbill, of course, is very exciting, not just because it would put me in the lead, but also because they are one of our most endangered bird species. Speaking of bird species that are not endangered, Brent has found one. Oh dear, it seems as though James, and he is of course James, I'm pretty sure I called him Brent there, it's James, he doesn't have any signal, leaving us free to approach this lovely elephant herd. And even if it doesn't count towards my total, we're still going to go and have a look at it because I love elephants. And as far as I'm concerned, seeing one will make any day absolutely complete. So we're going to go have a look at them anyway. Just making sure. I've nearly come around this corner and had a car accident before, which is very unusual out here. But of course we don't. We get out of the habit of looking both ways before we go onto a road, which we probably should do. And this is one of the main roads on Arethusa. I'm just making sure that there's no other vehicle coming. Hello, Elise. And for those of you who've been watching the Arethusa dam cam in between safari times, it looks as though these guys have been having a marvelous time in the dam. Hello, girls and boy. All right, over to James while we make an approach.
Batelier, 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 everybody. Beautifully caught by Brian Joubert in full glorious flight. Look at it go. Oh, that's incredible. Isn't that wonderful? Look at it go. I can't even see it with my naked eye. Which is fantastic. Look at it just hanging there in the air and so low down. The only bird out here that can fly that low and that completely gracefully. You see how it's adjusting all the time. Slight adjustment, slight adjustment, slight adjustment. No tail. Very unstable. That is just the most fantastic picture. Doesn't seem to be getting any further away or closer, actually. It must be just sort of circling in one spot. Beautiful, Brian.
Oh, thank you, James.
Yes. Super. On we go. I think let's go back to Jamie and her elephants. Just remind her that, unfortunately, we had those first. Ha 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 ha.
I saw that elephant that James put on screen, but I didn't have the long lens to stop for it. I was out first. Okay, that's fine. If James wants to be a sore winner, that's okay. He's forgotten that he has to go and set up fireside chat and I don't. So, you know, I'll have an extra few moments to help me win this competition. Lovely collection of big bulls, actually. At first, when I approached, I thought girls, and I just sort of thought to myself, my goodness, these are large ladies. But they're not. It's a bachelor herd of elephants, and they have pretty much obliterated two combretum trees next to each other. I mean, really, they totally have. There's hardly anything left of these poor trees that found themselves the center of attention of five large elephant bulls. There's something incredibly peaceful about a sighting like this, and it just goes to show that I will always put the needs of our viewers first, even if it means that it's a species that doesn't count in the competition. Munching and crunching away. And Miss Jin, while we watch our Ellie bulls size each other up and munch away at the bush willow, Miss Jin in Texas would like to send a big 4th of July shout out to all of her friends watching on YouTube. So I hope you're having a new stream. Sorry, not YouTube, you stream. I can't seem to get my words straight this afternoon. So a big shout out to all of Miss Jin's friends watching on Ustream. I hope you are having a marvelous day. And that these elephant balls make it even more so. All roughly around 20 years or just older, a couple of 25, some of the larger ones might be closer to 25, even up to 30. Beautiful gentleman. Oh, trunk full of sand. And I wish I could have been at Arethusa Dam when all of these gentlemen were having a mud bath, because it looks as though some of them went right in to the dam itself. There's one elephant bull that I always look for whenever I come across groups like this. I haven't seen him in a really long time, but I think he has been seen on a couple of the live safaris. There's an elephant bull with a really ragged ear and a completely dislocated or broken right hip. And he still walks on it, I think it's healed up, and he just walks with a limp because his one leg is longer than the other. But there's something very special about that particular elephant bull, and I haven't seen him in a long time. And the reason he comes to mind now is this is where I first saw him many months ago. It's amazing how used to, or how familiar you become with the different animals in the area, the longer you spend looking at them. And I think because we look through the eyes of the camera, we actually are more aware of the nuances of each individual animal. I think, boy, that bush willow is pretty much done for. It has been well and truly stripped. This is what we were talking about this morning on the Sunrise Safari. The fact that with this drought, we might actually see a change to the habitat completely. It will have an effect on it that will last for many, many years. And that's particularly because the elephants of this area, because there's no grass or nutrients within the grass, they're going to be targeting trees more and more frequently and clearing large areas of land. And if you combine that with the fact that the Kruger National Park has closed a whole load of its water holes on the western boundary, so the boundary with the Sabi Sands, we're going to be seeing more elephants as well coming in search of water. So this drought could actually shape this environment for years to come. He is having a wonderful time there, stripping away bits of bark. James has found another feathered friend.
White-crowned shrike, everybody. Very lucky. And I must just confess, it is a slight advantage we have over Jamie and David in that we have the super zoom camera. That bird is roughly the same distance away as Pluto is, and yet we've managed to get a relatively good picture of it. So that is the white-crowned shrike. They're sitting on a marula tree, and we are here on Cheetah Plains now, and we're heading for the clearings, hoping for ostriches and cheetah, and perhaps wildebeest and jackals, and all sorts of wonderful things like that. We might be lucky, we might not. It's quite cold here, and I was just saying to Brian this morning, Jamie kept reporting on the radio, or via Louise in the final control, that it was windy down here, and I kept saying, but are you sure it's windy down there? Because it was perfectly still on Juma. There's no question it's windier here than it is up there. And I mean, we're hardly... Oh, hoopoo. whoop, whoop. Whoop, whoop. Did you see it fly? Okay, Kirsten says you saw it. Right, we're taking it. That's number 35, I think, isn't it, Kirsten? 35, right?
35.
Yeah, 35.
Maybe 36.
Maybe 36. Oh, 16. Damn.
Close.
Anyway, it's quite breezy up here on cheetah plains, and that's astounding to me because it's really not far away. As the crow flies, we're probably no more than maybe 4 miles, if that. So I guess it must have to do with the height that we are and, of course, the big clearings that there are around here. Just in front of us. Of course, I've told myself that I wouldn't be competitive about this thing and that I didn't really care who won, and now I'm unable to be like that. Although, of course, it would be an honour to lose to Jamie Patterson. Brent was here, it would be a different story entirely. We'd be going at it hammer and tongs. But we should be right today. Even if Jamie wins, I shall graciously accept defeat. Oh, Brian, there's not a lot out here at the moment. Not for the odd hoo-poo. Okay, we're now going to go towards Three in a Row Pan. See what we can spot there. Some of the last remaining water. Oh, quickly, go across to Jamie. She's got a great bird.
And that was a very rapid link. Thank you very much for that, James. It sounds as though James has been quite magnanimous about this particular competition, saying that he wouldn't mind losing to me. That is, of course, because he's winning at present, so he has to say that. We'll see how things go when the tables have turned, naturally. Well, there you are, one of the prettiest of all of the bird species, and definitely one of the most striking, a black-headed oriole that will forever make me think of Sam, of course. Sam Chevalier was with us for a relatively short period of time, but he absolutely loved black-headed orioles. Well, there you go, that one was for Sam. Right, what's next? Just by the way, I left the elephants. They were moving off into some very dense vegetation. All of a sudden they decided that it was time to go, leaving us free to go and search for other animals. Apparently James is on 16. We are now on 12. We have 4 more to catch up with him to draw level. And then, of course, it's a matter of seeing who wins. Okay, we're starting to get to the tricky stage with the birds. We've kind of ticked off most of the obvious ones. Here's a squirrel. James has already done a squirrel. The squirrel that supposedly nearly died of old age. Oh, Dave, I've got a cruel one for you. Dave is going to hate me after this. Where is it gone? Oh, goodness. It's in that tree in the bush that is in front of us. If we keep zooming in a little bit to the right, a little bit to the right, the center of that bush, I think I just saw it fly away. There it is, there it is. You saw it? You all saw that? That was a chin spot battus, everybody. You definitely saw that, right? That definitely counts. Small little black and white bird called a chin spot battus that just flew off. And if you don't believe me, it's still there, but they don't really sit still. And we don't have the super zoom. The chin spot battus is still playing hard to get. However, James has elephants, and of course I'd just like to remind James that you can't count the same species twice.
But I can count the blacksmith lapwing that is standing behind that elephant. There it is. Ha 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 ha. So we've got that one and a massive herd of elephants. Look at this, everyone. Sitting at Three in a Row Pan. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, yeah. About 32, I think. I keep pulling out my microphone. Hang on one sec, Kirsten, I can't hear you, don't say anything. There we go. What else have we got here, Brian? It's just hundreds of elephants. Dozens of them. Chris? Thank you for your question. I'm just looking for yellow-billed oxpeckers, perhaps, on these beefaloes. There are also beefaloes here, by the way. Chris, you say, how long does it take for an elephant's tusks to erupt, and when do they erupt? Chris, they erupt. There's a whole lot more ellies coming now. Chris, an elephant's tusks apparently erupt at 18 months for a cow, and at least for 18 months for a bull, and 2 years for a cow, I've read. I'm not sure that that's entirely true, though. Because I think I've seen older elephants than that with no tusks. So, well, that's what I've read once in a textbook. Now, this is interesting. See how they've turned to face this young bull coming in? Young bull's creating consternation. And it's not unlike when, I think, you know, if you're a sort of group of adults and young kids, and then a whole lot of big bruising sort of football players come swaggering into an area, it just makes everybody feel slightly uncomfortable, and they, you know, the parents will circle around their kids and kind of be protective of them. That's exactly what happened there. Three young bulls came in to have a drink, and the rest of the elephants thought, well, let's just see what's going on here and make sure that everyone is safe. Does blacksmith lapwing on a nest count as two or just one? I think two, maybe four. All right, let's go across to Jamie. She's got a primate.
In this case, I have a primate that is not a human being and is in fact a vervet monkey, sitting in its usual spot around the Arethusa Lodge. So this is the Arethusa Dam Troop, one that we've become quite familiar with over the last few months. They're always around. And that, of course, is the back of Arethusa Lodge, just by the way, in case you're wondering about the various things. So we just wanted to show you that, a primate of a different description. We've got two primates now. Back to James and his elephants.
That's quite a cheeky thing. She got two primates. Anyway, I suppose she did. Ah, very nice that. It's a nice wilderness scene, don't you think there, Brian? Elephant playing with pipe. Super. Now, quite apart from the fact that that is not the best scene in the world, if you look at that elephant, I think that elephant's about 3 years old and doesn't have any tusks erupted yet. So, yeah, I'm not sure that you can accurately say exactly when they erupt, to be honest. There, you can just see them. They're just coming out now. Just below the skin there. That is a ridiculous scene. That's one of the pipes, obviously, that supplies this little pan with water. Beautiful, calm, pleasant scene here at three in a row pan. Hello, Bridge, you're in London. What a nice question from you. You said, do elephants live longer than crocodiles? Bridge, they don't. Crocodiles, believe it or not, can live to over 100 years. Now, that is an astonishingly long time for any animal, but reptiles, you'll find, are quite long-lived. Tortoises, leopard tortoises, we think can probably live for up to that length of time, and crocodiles certainly at least 100 years. Elephants in this area, 55 to 60 years, probably just about the maximum they can get to. That's a nice question. I've never thought of it like that, Bridge. Thank you. All right, I think let's move on from here and head towards the clearings. The elephants have been remarkable over the last little while. They're a real joy to have around. Let me just call those in. There's the dove, but I think Jamie's had ring-necked dove. That's what that was. Unfortunately. And watch out here for a three-banded plover, Brian. Oh, parrot! It's in that, it'll be in that marula tree somewhere. Let's just stop and have a quick look, everybody. If you can see the brown-headed parrot, whose most obvious feet, you've got it. You're a genius. Brown-headed parrot, everybody. Ha! Well done, Brian. Now, the brown-headed parrot, of course, has the most obvious feature being its bright green back. And you can hear it calling there, that very metallic call. I don't know if you know what I mean by the metallic call. It sounds like it's almost like a metal chisel hitting against an anvil, I guess. It's like a scrape. It's quite a harsh metal sound. Beautiful. All right, let's go across to Jamie. She's got a water buck, which she can't have, but she can have the other thing she's got. Dash it.
And the water buck might not count, but please don't tell him that, because he must be one of the most magnificent male water buck that I have ever seen. And then, of course, the giraffe behind him, which definitely does count. But before we go over to the giraffe, I just had to show you this waterbuck bull, because he is truly spectacular. Look at the power in those shoulders, and that dewlap that actually extends right down to his chest, giving him an enormous appearance. The symbol, of course, of the Sabi Sand, where we find ourselves right now. And a magnificent specimen like this, you can understand why that may be. Isn't he beautiful? Old boy. Deep ridged horns. Absolutely massive. I'd be guessing, but I'd say he must weigh 250, 300 kilograms, close to 600 odd pounds. He's huge. And gorgeous. Right, well, our giraffe was slowly making a tentative approach, and oh no, we've changed direction. An almost tentative approach in towards us, having a quick nibble of the leaves. A female, in this case, and I've totally lost track of what we're on in terms of totals, but that's okay. This is getting ridiculous. James continues to maintain a lead of 4 points. Oh, there goes our water buck ball. All right, let's go sneak up a little bit closer to our giraffe, see if we can't get a better view of her. So, James on 18, Jamie on 14, and yet the Arethusa Dam waits with bird species, where bird species abound. And hopefully that fish eagle that's calling in the distance is going to make an appearance. All right, Oxpecker, are you yellow-billed or red-billed? Whoops. Okay, girl, don't panic. It's all right. Quite an old giraffe cow. She's very dark in color. Some, of course, are darker than others. She's also relatively large for a female giraffe. And they do have a tendency to darken a little bit with age. Quite shy. She's not terribly comfortable with the vehicle around her, so we're not going to try and sneak up too close, but we'll follow behind because she's walking on the way to the Arethusa Dam, where there are jacanas, which I doubt James is going to find before me on Cheetah Plains. I'm relatively willing to bet he's not going to find on Cheetah Plains. I'm just thinking, something like a pangolin. Okay, just a pangolin. A pangolin is like the golden snitch in Harry Potter, and if you don't get that reference, basically, if you catch the golden snitch, then you inevitably win the game. Now, that knowledge, I suppose, makes me a giant nerd, but also the fact that I think the pangolin should be like a giant snitch. No, a golden snitch. And if we find one, we get 150 points. Essentially titling us game. Winners of the competition. So Dave, get on it, please. Dave being the only person so far who has spotted a pangolin, therefore has my utmost faith and trust in his ability to pull that off one more time. It is, of course, a huge ask of Dave. Here's another female giraffe over there, munching away on the guari bushes. They tend to be one of the few species that actually often eat the guari leaves themselves. Of course, lots of things feed off the guari berries, including human beings. They're quite sweet and tasty. And generally, the animals don't tend to feed off the leaves of the guari trees all that frequently. She's got quite wonky ossicones on the top of her head. Her horns slightly bent inwards, and that's probably as a result of a genetic defect rather than any kind of injury. It's those ossicones, rather than being called horns, in contrast to our waterbuck that we saw earlier, are made of solid bone, and a giraffe is born with them rather than growing them. Just so you know, I've been working on my giraffe silhouette hand puppetry, and you might be treated to that at some point in the next few days on a sunset safari. Haven't quite got it right though, and that of course is a reference to a sunset safari that occurred a few days ago, where we had a giraffe walking past in front of the sunset, and it looked so much like hand puppet or a shadow puppet. It was absolutely phenomenal, and you'll never be able to unsee it. Once you see it, you'll never be able to unsee it. Okay, onwards from our giraffe and through to Arethusa Dam to see what awaits us. Of course, James has already ticked off hippopotamus. And speaking of James, let's go and see how he's doing.
We stopped here at the pan, everybody, but there's nothing unique going on all right over here. Mud, quite a lot, but otherwise nothing going on there. A couple of doves, which we've already had. There's a crowned lapwing in this clearing, which we've already had. So now we're going to go down to the clearing just below here and see if we can't find maybe the Temminck courser. Scouring the clearings, I thought there might be some at least zebra or wildebeest here, but I think because it's a little windy and cold, you'll probably find they're all sitting in the thickets here, and they'll pop out maybe for a drink a little bit later. The fact that that pan's got no water in it means that that clearing is going to become fairly unused. Hello, Kathy in North Carolina. You say, where are all the baboons? Now, well, that is a very good question. We heard some alarm calling this morning south of us, south inside Little Gowrie, which is the reserve to the south of us. Now, we now know that Karula's gone in there. We also heard a male lion calling in there. So maybe those baboons were seeing the lion or that leopard. But, you know, they're not that common around here. We don't have a huge number of, well, we don't have a permanent, oh, there's a Cape Glossy starling, sorry, on the ground there. Not Cape Glossy, it's a greater blue-eared glossy starling. Greater blue-eared glossy starling. So we don't see a great number of baboons because there isn't a permanent water, a permanent river flowing through here, and so they don't have those huge big fig trees and things that they like to sit in. Right, now if I'm not mistaken, that's a greater blue-eared glossy, and in front of us there's a Cape Glossy, if you can believe it. Look at that. I'm claiming both of those. Now the reason you know the difference, no, it's not. That's a greater blue-eared as well, everybody. I'd love to claim it. but I'm not going to. I don't know. See if it calls. Brian, on the base of the termite mound there, there's a little brown bird. It's a rattling cisticola on the ground. Can you see it? Yeah, you got it. Well done, Brian. That is the advantage of this cheating with the super zoom camera. Alrighty, let's move on from here. But we do get baboons coming through, and you know what? We've had them coming through more and more over the last little while. Come on, Rusty. That's it. On you go. They've been definitely been coming through for... Oh dear, I feel like my lead is going to be eroded now. Let's go to Arethusa Dam with Jamie.
He just flew away.
Oh no. Fishy, oh, it's okay. He's coming towards us. He's coming closer, Dave. It's okay. There we go. We have found our African fish eagle, one of the most beautiful of all of the eagle species, and of course with the most iconic call that I would love for you to hear again. Unfortunately, it'll be accompanied by the sounds of angle grinding from elsewhere. Isn't he beautiful? We'll go and get a closer, well, we'll hopefully go and get a closer view of him in a moment. But we have arrived at Arethusa Dam, and I have to tell you, it's sort of bleak out here. We've got the standard Egyptian goose. There we go, we can tick that one off as well. Just one pair at the moment, settling down to bask in the afternoon light. That is the Egyptian geese. At one point there were, I think, I love that fish eagle call. We'll see if we can't get closer so that we can hear it clearly. Oh good, you did hear it clearly. The most distressing sight, I have to say, arriving at Arethusa Dam, is the poor hippo that is in the mud. I barely realized it was a hippo. I thought at first it was a rock, but that, I think, is the hippopotamus. Shame. Life is really getting very tough for these poor animals. There's very little space left.
We've got that bird, Jamie.
We do have that bird, Dave. Unfortunately, that is a Cape Turtle dove. Very sad. And then, oh, we've got the catfish as well, which I don't think count as a bird species or a mammal species. But again, one of the sad sights of the drought. You can see them splashing around in there. A scene similar to, for those of you who were watching last year, as Treehouse and Twin Dams and the Vuyatela Dam and Buffleshook Dam all dried up, we watched as the catfish slowly struggled. And I feel as though the poor guests of Arethusa, unless they go in and clear away those catfish, or clear away the catfish that actually die. Oh no, there's guinea fowl over there. Quickly, Dave, quickly, because Kirsty wants to send us to a Steenbok. There you go, guinea fowl, and then across to James.
There is a Steenbok, everybody. That is all that we've managed to find in the clearings here. We're just scanning the landscape, though, for signs of other creatures. Okay, let's carry on. Very nice to have had guinea fowl for you and Jamie. Very unpleasant for us that you have had guinea fowl with Jamie. Not so, Brian. It's deeply unpleasant. Yes. I feel very hurt by it. Here are the great plains of Cheetah Plains, which miraculously are empty. Now we're still only four ahead. Every time we find something, Jamie finds two more things. It's dreadful. I feel a dreadful sense of pressure. Right, we're going to go and look in the next clearings and see if there aren't a herd. Ooh, no, those are starlings we've had before. I was hoping to find ostriches here. Nah, nothing. Oh, I can hear We will see them, the magpie shrike. They're here, Brian, I can... Can you hear them? Can you see them? Oh, no! Where are they, Brian? Scan everywhere. I think they're... Where? Where lookest thou? Temminck's courser? No, it's not. But it's not something we've seen before. It's a ground... Where is it? Where are you looking? There, okay, I got it now. Wait, everybody. It's a pipit. African pipit. Pipit. 22. Pipit. Now, we're going to find these magpie shrikes, which are calling. Pipette. Ooh, there we go, Brian. There's a Temminck's courser. Yeah, there it is. See there on the junction? Two Temminck's coursers. Very nice, Brian. How beautiful are those birds, everybody? Look at their copper colours. I can see another pair across the road inside Mala Mala. That must be the Mala Mala pair of Temminck's coursers. These are the Cheetah Plains coursers. I think they're an astoundingly wonderful colour. I can hear many magpie shrikes calling. None of them... Oh, there we go. I've seen them, Brian. See that? You got it. Right, magpie shrike, everybody. Oh, dear. There we go, magpie shrike, well done. Many creatures we have got. Many creatures more we need. It's a lovely afternoon out here. There is it's quite chilly breeze blowing, I must tell you. Those Temminck's courses are brilliant. Joey, you're in Australia, and you want to know what the chance of seeing a sesame are on Cheetah Plains. Very small, Joey, I'd say almost negligible. Sesame, a bit like the roan and the sable and the Wildebeest, not water-dependent, need to be away from other water-dependent grazers like impala and zebra, and so we just don't see a lot of them around here. You used to see quite a few, and you see them very nicely in Botswana, in the Okavango. You see them beautifully there. Is that that's the pipette? You can see why he might be termed an LBJ. Not so. Now, Kathy, you're in Michigan, and you want to know what characteristics make a shrike a shrike. Kathy, the most notable thing about a shrike, I mean, I'm sure there are a number of genetic things that make a shrike, but the most characteristic thing is the tooth on the end of the bill. And all shrikes have got this tooth on the end of the bill. They're carnivorous, largely. They will eat, the grey-headed bush shrike will actually eat other birds. Most of them will eat insects and reptiles and that sort of thing, but they're all sort of carnivorous. And you know, those are the most notable things about the shrikes. It's that hooked bill, that's the most obvious thing. Some of them migrate, some of them don't. But the hooked bill is what distinguishes them most obviously from any other. I keep getting this microphone cable of mine stuck. It's going to result in my losing my temper very shortly, and then there'll be trouble. Let me plug myself back in. Right, I'm back in, Kirsten. Sorry about that. There must be a zebra here. I've seen thousands of zebras around here. That was quite a good return there, Brian. What are we on? 48 now?
49.
49. Excellent. Jamie on 3 or something. It was 2. 49-2. We're doing very well then. person says Jamie's on 300. That's, of course, absolute rubbish. He's still my heart. Now, we're coming into the next clearings here. And with any luck, there will be a great plethora of zebra knocking about with some wildebeest in tow and some ostrich. Ooh, and Carol, you say thanks to this competition, you've managed to add 3 birds to your bird list and you're up to 129. That's fantastic. I'm really impressed with that. These clearings are rather devoid of life this afternoon. Oh well, can't win them all. Sometimes can't win any. Ah, there is a Senegal lapwing. Senegal lapwing, everybody. And while you're looking at the Senegal lapwing, I shall scan the rest of the clearings. Beth, you want to know when the plovers were renamed to lapwings? Beth, they weren't all renamed to lapwings. It's the little ones. You know the plovers that you get on the coast? They're smaller birds. They're actually a different family. And so something like three-banded plover. There we go. Three-banded plover is very closely related to those coastal plovers, the small plovers, lots of white on them. And these birds, the lapwings, are actually an entirely different family. And so that's why they were renamed. And that was some time back. I think it was around the year 2000. They're rather special, aren't they? They've all got such nice individual characteristics. So that's the Senegal lapwing. Don't see anything else going on in these clearings. We'll move up ahead. And they've got a very similar strategy to the courser that we saw. They run along the ground and catch ants and termites and that sort of thing. Now, they can fly very well, but they don't do a great deal of flying when they're looking for food. Come on, Brian, where are your ground hornbill friends? I think they don't like the cold. All right, we'll just stick our noses in here and then we'll turn probably back towards the west. Ah, there's a little bee eater. Have you got it there, Brian? Straight in front of us, 2 very small, 1 dead stick, 1 living one. That's it. Up a little. You got him. Ah, oh, well done. Little bee eater. Kirsten, you keep count. That's number 386 for us. Kathy, you you want to send a shout out to your friend, whose name is Kerry. Sorry, Kerry, you want to send a shout out to Kerry. Okay, Kirsten, just go with that again. I'm afraid the comms are not great. Terry with a T and Kathy with a C. To Patty with a P. And who's sending the shout out?
Patty.
Terry is sending a shout out to Patty for introducing her to Safari Live. There we go. Thank you. And I hope that you're having a wonderful 4th of July and perhaps you're watching together. Sorry about that, Terry and Patty, as opposed to Kerry and Kathy. No, it's not that I'm going deaf, it's that we're at the far eastern end of Cheetah Plains, and it's impossible to hear what Kirsten is saying. I'm going to quickly call in that herd of elephants that we had earlier. Oh, there's a giraffe. giraffe in front of us. We'll just try and ease up there. Stations, there was a herd of elephants moving south from Three in a Row Pan about 5 minutes ago. Also a small herd of buffalo there. There we've got a nice giraffe. Unfortunately, Jamie's already seen a giraffe. Which doesn't make the giraffe any less important. Did Jamie see a giraffe cow or a giraffe bull? Because don't you think we should get another? Oh, look at the one lying down here, Brian. Definitely we get a point for lying down giraffe, don't you think?
At least
1 point. And Jamie had a female. We got lying down and female. Oh, we don't have a bull. That's a young bull. Half a point? I'm not getting any joy from the final control today. Jennifer, you're looking at that giraffe. I think it is actually a young cow with her little ossicones sticking out of the top of her head. And you're wondering if they're solid bone or not. They are absolutely solid bone. And we have a wonderful giraffe skull in the camp that has a nest of stingless bees living in the cranium, or certainly within the skull, where the brain used to be. And you can see the ossicones, you can feel them, and they are completely bone. If I'm not mistaken, they differ from horns by not being attached at birth. So they're born with the ossicones at birth. They don't erupt from the skull like horns do. And then they fuse onto the skull from the base. And that's how they differ from horns. Antlers, of course, those things that deers have that fall off every year. And then the other kind of sort of a protuberance that comes off a head is something that the pronghorn antelope has. And the pronghorn antelope of North America, which I'm sure is also enjoying the 4th of July, is not in fact an antelope at all, but it does have a different kind of horn entirely, and I'm not entirely sure how that functions. But those are the four types of horns that you get on sort of herbivorous animals, and it does... Yeah, it largely defines which family they fall into. Alrighty. Let's move on from here. We'll go into the clearings of Nkoro. Well, not into them. We'll just look into them. We drive into them. We'll be arrested, Brian. And then we won't get any more birdies and things. I thought I saw something in this tree. And it's very bright in my eyes. I didn't, it was a piece of the tree. How surprising. This is a particularly confiding giraffe cow. Look at her. She's standing so close to us. And I'm sure she's the mother of that other little one lying down. She's feeding on a tree that the elephants have mangled many times. And it's a Combretum calinum, I think a variable bush willow. Look at her. That was all disdain, wouldn't you say, Brian? I'd say that was a look of absolute disdain. Very nice. Now, we know, of course, that giraffe don't love that sort of the tannin that you find in those sorts of trees, and so she won't be able to eat on it forever. And because it's winter time, you'll find that the tannin levels of the trees have dropped, and so she'll be able to eat more of these than she would in the summer, and you very seldom see them eating combretum leaves in the summertime. I don't know if you can hear it there, but she's chewing, and you can hear the crunching of the leaves. Look at the light behind her, too. It's just very beautiful. Wonderful. So nice. Great stuff. Alrighty, on we go. Let's see what else we can find around the corner here. Duiker, of course, still up for grabs, everyone. Wildebeest, zebra. What other antelope? Nyala. Bushbuck. Sable. Sharps, Gresbok. Unlikely. Gemsbok. Pronghorn antelope. I don't think I'm trespassing now, am I? No. Ah. No, but I will be soon. Let me turn around here. That's the Kruger boundary there. Now, we don't want to go into the Kruger National Park because if we thought we were going to be arrested on Ankoro, well, it'll be a new level of arresting if we're going to wander into the Kruger Park. It won't be very nice, Brian. I don't fancy an evening in the cells. Alrighty, so we're going to head off to the west. We'll go back past the pan there, into the clearings, and then probably make our way back sort of towards Juma in time for the fireside chat, where we will be talking about cubs. We've had some lovely cubs, so we'll have some George and Charlotte highlights. Valeria, you say that if Jamie wins, then I have to wear her beanie. I'm just waving at Ephraim there from Cheetah Plains. Okay, I'm happy to wear Jamie's beanie. If Jamie is happy for me to wear her ridiculous beanie with that enormous pom-pom on it, it's become quite a character, that thing, hasn't it? She says I can wear it. Oh, apparently it's not Jamie's beanie. It belongs to Kirsten Mack Smith. Therefore, it is inevitably a beautiful beanie. There are some, unfortunately, Natal Spurfowl, which we've seen already. Shall we call them Shelley's Franklins and get on with it? Or what?
Or Kirky
Franklin. Franklin. Melanistic, not leucistic. Leucistic Kirky Franklins without gold head. Fossicking around in the elephant dung. They're looking for probably dung beetle larvae, which they're not going to really find. Termites they'll definitely find in there, and various other beetles and things that like to eat the dung. It's actually quite a nice sighting of a Natal Spurfowl. We'll just ease our way around them. You see they didn't run away, very confiding. They're habituated, Brian. Habituated Natal Spurfowl. Feel like we need to add to our tally almost immediately. Let's get around the corner here. I've no doubt there's going to be a great plethora of creatures. No. A tortoise would be nice. Oh, we can't count reptiles, can we? Well, I think the rule was birds and mammals only. Otherwise, Jamie will count those fish you saw. Can't have catfish in such a prestigious competition as this. The winter 4th of July mammal off. Now Jamie was just saying, I remember this morning she drove down through here and she was saying how this soil that we're on is this red color because of the iron oxide in it. And it's interesting because it's the only patch of this red soil that I know here, and I've said this before, it reminds me so very much of the sort of eastern coast of our country, around Natal, KwaZulu-Natal, which is the eastern province of the country, and it's got this lovely rich red soil. That's where Kirsten's from. She's got red hair, you see. Maybe she's got lots of iron oxide in her. What do you think, Brian?
Most likely.
Most likely, hey. It does, yes. It explains her rather sort of stern nature. We are going to be in a lot of trouble when we get home. Okay, we're popping out now into the clearings and we'll see what we can find. And Chris Rogue, you wanted to give a shout out to the hyena group on Facebook. Yes, absolutely, we could do that with pleasure. So here it is, a shout out to the hyena group on Facebook. It's called the Hyenas of Juma and Arethusa, and it's a wonderful group which keeps tabs on all the hyenas that we have here. And if you want to know about the hyenas, how to identify them, where they are, where they live, what the updates are, it's a great way to do it. And it's a brilliant group. So thank you, Chris, and thank you to all of you who maintain it. It's a great resource, it really is. Some blue wax bills. And that's for the 4th of July, of course. Did you see the blue wax bills? There we go, blue wax bill, everybody. Yes, please. I can't believe how excited I'm getting by seeing a blue wax bill. There we go. Bounce, bounce, bounce. Very nice. Oh, there's something else down there. That might be a cinnamon bun bird. You see on the little ones on the ground there? It may have moved. No, there's still two blue wax bills there. If you're wondering where Jamie is, everybody, she is waiting to get into a rather special sighting, so that's why you're not with her. A special sighting that will give her how many points, Brian?
Half.
Oh, correct. Yeah. Maybe one. Now, I don't know where those other things went. Gracie, we may have just seen a cinnamon bun bird, but I'm not sure. That's a pity. Let's go a little bit forward. We might see them again. These grassy clearings are always a little bit productive. There we go. Now, keep an eye on the ground here, Brian. They would have landed somewhere around here. Cinnamon bun bird, where are you? Cinnamon bun bird, where are you? No, I see not the cinnamon bun bird. Sorry, Gracie. We'll keep looking, I promise. Right, let's go back down towards that pan. Hello, Viv. I'm really struggling to hear the final control, but if I hear your question correctly, you want to know if there are ever records, any records of birds attacking humans in Africa. Is that correct? Affirmative. Right. Viv. Yes, I mean, yes, a little bit, like that crowned lapwing over there. If you get too close to their nests, they will attack you, or they'll fly over the top of your head and they'll dive bomb you and make you feel very uncomfortable, but they won't do any harm to a human being. The bird that you've got to watch out for is a human being. Well, I guess there are two. If you're a very small human being of about 2 or 3 years old, then the thing you need to watch out for is probably a crowned eagle. A crowned eagle in some areas will attack people. Very seldom, and not if there are adults around, but if you live in an area where crowned eagles occur and you've got kids playing in a garden, or kid on his own playing in a garden, it is quite possible the crowned eagle could take him or her, but it's unlikely. The bird you'd have to watch out for the most that could do physical damage to you would be an ostrich. An ostrich can do serious damage, and they have killed people from time to time, and what they do is they kick. I think much like an emu does, they kick, but they kick forward and they hack. Is that just a piece of tree? I think it is. Yeah, it's a bark, piece of bark. I thought it was maybe a kill hanging from the tree there. They kick forward, and when they kick forward, they can sort of grab you here and they'll disembowel you. And so that's what you need to watch out for with a giraffe. And not a giraffe. Did I just say that? Did I really just say that? I did, didn't I? Yeah. No, not a giraffe, an ostrich. A giraffe will kick you, but with both legs, back and front, they can kick. But otherwise, you'd be safe from the birds here. No Alfred Hitchcock-esque scenes have played out here in Africa where swarms of nasty birds attack and kill people. And it played on a very nice phobia, that film, you know. People don't like that flapping, the flapping wings around. And when I was a kid, certainly before I was became a bush person, there's something tremendously psychologically awful about a bird flying around in a confined space, the flapping wings. And I remember being deeply troubled by birds flying about in a room, if a bird came into the room, for example. I'm still scouring the land. I can hear some crombecks. It's the same as a bat. You know how if a bat flies onto your face? Well, that can be a very unpleasant experience, don't you think, Brian? I think I've spotted a herd of impala, Brian. I have. Way the other side of the clearing there. I still don't see hide nor hair of a zebra. And there were so many of them here recently. I think we're going to have to leave these clearings, Brian. Okay, let's go down to them and then we'll head further to the west. All right, let's go across to Jamie, get an update. She'll tell you a little bit about the surprise sighting that she's got to show you shortly, I hope.
Okay, guys, so we've sort of not counted ourselves out of this competition, but we have basically counted ourselves out of this competition, but that's because we have a really, really special surprise for you. What we're doing here, I know I'm quite quiet, I'm whispering because we're not actually that far away from where we need to be. It's been made a one vehicle lock, and we happened to become first on standby just because we got really, really lucky, and Ryan from Arethusa is incredibly kind to us. We found him as he found the surprise. So it's one vehicle only. We are waiting for Ryan to finish up and enjoying his time with the animal that he tracked, and then we will be able to go in and have a look at whatever it is. I think he's about to call me in. Standing by. Absolutely no problem, Ryan. Take your time. We'll do a loop. Cool. Okay. So Ryan's just asking for an extra 10 minutes because things have changed in the sighting and it's become even more exciting. I'm not really keen on telling you what it is, but I think most of you will have guessed by now and guessed just as to where we are. Suffice to say, it's been a while since we last saw this particular surprise. But we're going to wait here until it's time for us to pull in. We're going to give Ryan plenty of time because he tracked and found the surprise on foot. All right, back over to James, who is probably by now streaks ahead in this competition, but that's okay because we've got even better things planned.
Ah, crested barbet, everybody. I'm not sure if she told you what she was going to look at, but it does sound very exciting. And I'm rather jealous and excited for you. Anyway, I think you're going to enjoy it nevertheless. Right, there it is, the crested barbet. Very nice, very nice, very nice. Let's go back towards three in a row pan, and then we're going to head out of Cheetah Plains. You can see some lovely cloud formations all over the place. We're now 10 ahead, everybody. That's 10.
Quite a few, Brian, don't you think?
I think so.
I'm very impressed with us. I think we're amazing. Especially as it's Jamie. You know, she's rather good at this sort of thing. Okay, we're going to move quite quickly down this way. Because we've covered this area before. Oh! Wildebeest! There it is. Yes. Hello, Karen. You wanted to do a shout out to all, or for special 4th of July shout out to all the chatters on YouTube, Ustream, and what's the other one? Nat Geo. Nat Geo Wild, Ustream, and YouTube. Thank you to all of you for the time that you give us. It really is much appreciated, and without you, of course, this would just be two idiots driving around the bush looking at animals. It's much more fun with a whole lot of people to share it with us from all over the world. And on today, of course, in America, the Philippines and Rwanda. He's quite a splendid fellow. On his own. And unusual that he hasn't found a herd of impala to lurk around with. See that lovely brindled colour around his ears and onto his neck. He's got quite a long coat, you know. He's got a little bit fluffy for the winter time. That's very nice. And look at him. That's a brilliant picture. So he's obviously eating grass. That's pretty clear. But he's also eating relatively short grass. And apparently they'll tell you that the zebra eats slightly longer grass than them. And if you watch a warthog feed, I don't know how many of you watched the last time we super zoomed a warthog snout feeding. They scuffle under just lower down than where that wildebeest is eating. And you can see he's getting a little bit of the stolons, that's the underground stems, but largely it's the leaves. This is fantastic. Hey, this is actually a very, very nice area for them to be grazing. And his nose twitching away there. And these guys will maintain, they'll maintain a lawn. And you can see, I mean, this kind of grass cannot be that nutritious. And that's fine for a little bit, but after a while, especially as the dry season progresses, it'll be more and more difficult to maintain condition. Does that wildebeest have one eye? No, there it is. There's the eye. Phew. Know what that hole is just below the eye. We don't often get to spend time like this with a wildebeest, I've got to tell you. It's a very special little sighting. Not quite as special as the one that Jamie's taking you to, but almost. Don't you think, Brian? Yeah, I mean, look at that. That's spectacular. I wonder if we were to open the shot on, or open, come live with a picture like that, if you'd be able to identify what animal it was. And the mane. This is so cool. And you can see the stripes very clearly there. We don't tend to think of them as being striped animals, but they are. We think it helps break up the outline, and maybe not quite as black and white as the zebra, but definitely covered in stripes. You can hear a completely silent afternoon. There's no birds calling at all. I think that's got to do with the cold, I would say. I might be wrong. But I think that's what it is. What do you think, Brian?
I think so too.
Mm-hmm. All right, everyone, let's move on from here. Wonderful wildebeest. Now, Kitra in India, you want to know about the wildebeest migration and whether they have one here in Kruger. Chitra. Sorry, I'm struggling to hear the names, as you can see, as Kerry and Kathy will attest to. Chitra, no migration in the Kruger, no. There used to be, apparently, between the permanent water sources of, say, the Sand River or the Sabi River, and then during summer they'd migrate up to the perennial rivers like the Timbavati. Now, there are two reasons I don't do that anymore. One is the provision of artificial water, so you've seen those pans. We were at those water holes today, and so that means they don't have to move from one game reserve to the other. And then also the drying up of some of the perennial rivers, or at least of the annual rivers. So if you go up to an area like the Timbavati, there's a massive, massive riverbed there with a river that only flows probably once a year and only for a couple of hours at a time. That used to flow during the summer and keep permanent pools just about all the time. And that doesn't happen anymore. And that means that there's no point in this great migration going up there because there isn't any real water. But yes, absolutely, there used to be a migration, but humans placing water everywhere has put paid to that wonderful migration. And the number of wildebeest. Wildebeest like to migrate, and there are substantially fewer wildebeest in this area than there were, say, 30 years ago. Well, I thought I saw something there, but I think it was just the light flashing through that broken down piece of bark. Rather good of Jamie to give us this time, don't you think? And Larry, you say you were watching that unbelievable BBC show, The Hunt, and you were watching the wildebeest taken out by those wild dogs. It is an astonishing, astonishing sequence, that. And the technicality, I found the watching the behind the scenes thing afterwards even almost as fascinating as watching those wild dogs hunting. But they have managed again to put together a unique sort of sequence on how things happen in the wild. A really brilliant, brilliant scene. And if you haven't seen it, everyone, do yourselves a favor and go and hear David Attenborough narrate you through an unbelievable wild dog sighting. I think it was taken in Botswana, if I'm not mistaken, with some astonishing equipment, but really spectacular stuff. And to see any animal at eye level, I mean, they film these dogs pretty much at their eye level. To see any animal at eye level is just moving at eye level is so unusual, because you know we have our human perspective, and to get right down on the ground and watch how an animal moves is I think it was just brilliant. They got a wonderful tiger hunt as well, and you should if you haven't seen, there's a very, very large elephant. We know this guy, he's a tuskless bull, enormous tuskless bull, and that's not totally uncommon. It's not usual, but it's not that common either. Unfortunately, every time I push Rusty's clutch in, it goes. I'm just going to wait here a second. He's got a little bit of a fright from us. Paul, you want to know if it hurts when the tusks break? It will. Paul, it's just like you pulling a tooth out without an anesthetic. I'm sure it hurts horribly, and there's a very long nerve inside the tusk, but this animal hasn't broken his tusks, I don't think. I think that he was born without them, and that does happen every so often with these elephants. They're born without tusks. You've got to be a little bit wary of them. They can sometimes, or so I'm told, tend to be slightly more aggressive because they've been bullied. But I've never seen that, and this guy doesn't seem to be at all. And you can see how he's enormous. I mean, he's a fully grown bull, and he's got no tusks at all. We'll just stop here and let him come into the clearing next to us. I'm sure he's going to have a drink at the pan there. Oh, I can hear a southern black tit. Isn't that nice? Very strange to see a big behemoth-like bull without any tusks. Very odd indeed. You can see where the tusks would have erupted, but they ain't there no more. Oh, and I can hear a red-crested Korhan. He does look a bit sad without tusks, don't you think, Brian?
No.
A bit mournful. Let's follow him down to the water. We'll follow him at a distance. I think he's in must. I can't smell anything. Oh, there's another big bull. This waterhole is elephant central. We'll just drive very slowly behind him and enjoy him. Let's see another one there. Walking very slowly towards the water to have a drink. He's not in a rush. All right, everybody, Jamie's got a surprise for you, and I don't think she can be there very long, so let's go straight across to her now.
This is definitely a sighting that we've been looking forward to having. It's Shadow, guys. Shadow, and somewhere hidden in here is Shadow's cub as well. She's got a monkey kill that she's currently feeding on, crunching away. I don't know where the cub is, so I'm speaking very... Oh no, that's a log. That's not a leopard cub, that's a log. This will be my very first time seeing Shadow's cub, and it's the first time I've seen Shadow in ages as well. So we're absolutely really privileged to be here, and so lucky that Ryan called us in when he did. As James mentioned, we can't be here for too long for a couple of reasons, the main one being that it is starting to get dark, and there are a couple of other vehicles that would very much like to come and see the sighting. So we've just got to hope that Shadow's little one decides to show itself. There we go, we've got it. Well spotted, Dave. Oh my goodness. It's okay, little one. Hi. It is lovely to meet you. Heard so many good things about you. What's your clever mom got? Oh, look at this. Absolutely incredible. He's stalking mom already. And so beautifully relaxed. Oh, this is so incredible. Shadow's little 4-month-old female cub. How lucky are we? Hi. Aren't you gorgeous? This is absolutely the best way that this day could have gone. I'm so excited. The first time I've seen this cub. So for those of you who are joining us for the first time, you're watching a 4-month-old leopard cub live from the African bush. It really doesn't get better than this. Look how relaxed it is. Can I have some too, Mum? Absolutely fantastic. This is Karula's daughter, Shadow, and Karula's granddaughter. So much smaller and fluffier than Karula's cubs are now. Sneaking around towards Mum. Obviously, Mum not in the mood to share. So little cub is finding other ways of amusing itself, including sniffing the apple leaf. Our Shadow, when she first had these cubs, decided to den them on a main road. And what that meant was... Oh! You've got to know which branches will bear your weight and which ones won't, I guess. Little Phlegm and Grimace. I didn't even know that they're Phlegm and Grimace this young. How amazing is that? Almost imagining it going right to the edge of that branch and then being flung upwards like a spring. What's there? What smells so nice? Hmm? Something smells very interesting on this apple leaf. And James, the closet royalist, apparently has been calling this little cub Zara. This is absolutely magical in this afternoon light. Oh, flop. Flop. Simply marvelous. Thank you, Shadow, for this very special moment. This monkey won't last very long, and unfortunately neither will this sighting for us. We will have to leave very, very soon, but this has been such a marvelous moment, but we can't deny other people the opportunity to view this sighting in this glorious dappled afternoon light. And hello to safari lover Elaine, while we watch one of our newest additions to our Safari Live family. You want to know why they're called cubs and not kittens? So the babies of all of the big cats, which fall into a different, oh goodness, genus, a different genus to our domestic cats and the smaller cats, they are given a different terminology. They're called cubs rather than kittens, because they're part of the Panthera family. I think Shadow's about to cough up a hairball. She's making the most peculiar burping sounds. She might have eaten a bit too fast. I'm so thrilled. It was worth losing the competition just for this. And Dean, in Nelspruit, you were wondering, as Shadow provides us with a few burps, what the chances are of Shadow and Karula's cubs having the same father. Get a little bit of food. There we go. She only ate half of it. She left the rest for her cub. And the answer is very, very high. They both mated with Tingana, and we think that Karula also mated with Anderson. We know that Shadow definitely did. So whilst it's impossible for us to know, chances are there's a very high percentage chance that the cubs have the same dad. Of course, Leopard's not bound by the conventions of the traditional family. Guys, we do have to go. We can't hog the sighting. It's just one of those things that's been found at sunset. I have to call in the next person. Let me just get onto the Game Drive channel, find out where they are. Station on first standby for Shadow and Bontuan. What's your position? Okay, copy. If you want to start making your way, I'll pull out when you get here. Okay, so we've got about 2 minutes or so before we have to... I know I've put us in an awkward place, but I don't want to scare the little cub away. I think we're okay, though. I think this little cub is incredibly relaxed around vehicles, so let's try to get a nice view before we have to pull out. Okay, we're just going to switch on and let the engine run a little bit. Okay, cub hasn't stopped feeding. Shadow hasn't stopped grooming. Stop there, I don't want to scare it at all. So even if it's not the best view in the world, we'll settle for it. There's Shadow, the marvelous mother. Well done, girl. Caught a monkey. Clever, clever girl. Giving herself a jolly good groom. Just goes to show, guys, the sacrifice that leopard mothers make for their cubs. She left most of that kill, and I think she was hungry, judging by the speed at which she ate it. She left most of that kill for the little one, who unfortunately has dragged it into a very awkward position. I can just see some movements behind the leaves. Now, apart from birds of prey, leopards are pretty much the only thing that are capable or agile enough to catch a very sharp-eyed and agile monkey. Oh, little cub, come on, one last view. Sorry. One last, there we go, thank you. And while our little cub feasts on mom's monkey, Canada Keith, how common is a monkey kill for a leopard? Relatively. I couldn't give you an exact percentage. If I had to guess what percentage of its diet it makes up, maybe between 10 to 15%, maybe a little bit less. It's something we can double check what James thinks on the fireside chat while I gloat about the cub and he gloats about his victory in our ranger race. But they are, as I said, probably the only mammal agile enough to, one of the few mammals to agile enough to regularly catch a monkey. Oh! Amazing. So tiny and already weaned, but little teeth not always that strong, or at least the jaw muscles not quite strong enough to pull away the meat, and a bit of shaking is what's necessary. Kelly in Florida, you're right, it might not be a pangolin. Oh, look at that. Isn't that incredible? I think we deserve a lot of points for this. Actually, to be honest, Kelly, Ryan and his tracker deserve a lot of points for this. And he made that point when he left the sighting. He asked to just remind me that the six ones that will be delivered to him later will be cold upon arrival. And some of you will understand exactly what I'm talking about when I say that. We do owe Ryan big time for the sighting. And a little bit of luck as well. I can't really claim any credit for this. This is incredible. Absolutely incredible. A bit macabre. but incredible nonetheless. The monkey presenting something of a challenge for little leopard teeth. Yes, little cub, I hear the sound of the vehicle too, on its way. Oh, look at that. There's going to be a smile on my face for the rest of the day, possibly the rest of the week. Very gruesome. Decidedly gruesome. Oh. Standing by. Copy. I'm pulling out now. Okay, guys, time for us to go. One last look at the cub. Absolutely extraordinary. Thank you, Ryan. Thank you, Shadow. Oh, look at that. Oh, you naughty little thing. Okay, guys, we have to go. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. How incredible was that? Hissing at Mom. Little brat. Goodness gracious! Mom provides dinner and then gets hissed at by a cub. Absolutely incredible. Okay. Let us make our way out for the other vehicle to approach. While we shuffle around here, it seems it's an afternoon full of babies. Back over to James.
This ridiculous creature in front of us. Hello. Yes, you're so big and brave. Look at him. He's got his face in the mud. I can't even see him. Sorry, and the mother is just next to us. She doesn't care less. She thinks he's being ridiculous as we do. This is just too wonderful for words. He's thinking about touching the car, you know. He's too close for my... Sorry, we're going to have to move. We just had to turn the car off on, everybody, because there is the mother got a little bit irritated. How's the audio now, Kirsten? Just suckling now, look at that. She wasn't irritated at all with us. She just obviously thought the baby was getting too close. She's very close now. She's only about 3 feet from us. No. Come on, little fellow. You stay with your mum. It's fascinating. You know, she was watching us so carefully. And she wasn't in the slightest bit worried about us. Look at it suckling there. It's an unbelievable picture. She's so lovely, look at her. She's got such a calm about her face, but that'll get very changed completely if she decides that we're a threat to her little baby. And the baby turned us into a bit of a threat there. I don't think it was us at all. Isn't she lovely? Unbelievable sighting. Now my plan, everybody, was to take you to some mating lions. And I'm not sure that we're going to make it in time for the fireside chat, because this is too special for words.
so close to us. I find myself leaning towards the left of where I'm sitting because she is so very close. She's now kind of dropping off. That is an incredible picture, people. We don't see that. You can see how the suckling takes place. Throwing some dirt. She's too close for me to take a picture with my camera. I'm having to use my phone. Which is just amazing. She's only 3 feet from the car. Hey, 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 don't be silly. Stay there. Well, don't laugh at it, you're encouraging it. This is unbelievable. That shadow you can see, oh, you can't see it actually, that, yeah, let's just stay exactly on that picture, it's just too wonderful. Look at her trunk there, Brian, you can see my shadow on it. Go on then, you've been tremendously kind to us, thank you very much. No, no, you being silly, that's it, stay with your mum. That is just... Thank you. No, no, don't worry. We're not in any shape, way or form of danger to you, I promise. Off you go. Ah, wow. I think we're going to skip those lines because we're going to have to go to our fireside chat. Just remember the fireside chat, everybody. Look at that. Sun is going to be on our normal stream. So I know many of you struggled with that Facebook streaming thing that we tried to do, and we will do that again once we've got decent bandwidth to do it with. There's another tiny little one. Also a little bull. Trying to climb a tree like Zara. I just had to get that in there. Gee whiz. So what happened there, I think, everyone, was she was completely relaxed with us. She didn't even look around. That little thing came too close. I mean, that little thing was half a foot from the car when she turned and she thought, no, 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 that's too much. She came to within what, Brian? I mean, she came to within sort of 2 feet of us, maybe. And then she stopped as I started the engine. And she didn't kind of... She wasn't angry. She was just kind of saying, whoa, what's going on here? I don't understand. Let's just... Let's everybody back off from each other. And the little one did, and then she was fine. You saw her nearly drop off there. She nearly fell asleep. Her eyes went shut, and that little thing was suckling. I don't know that we've ever had a shot like that before. Yes, you're going to get us into trouble, little bull elephant. Hey! Michael, you want to know how much milk a little fellow like this is going to drink a day? I actually don't know, Michael. That's a really good question. I really couldn't tell you. I'm going to guess at around probably, this is a real guess. I'm going to say 5 to 10 liters a day. Now, I mean, that's ridiculous because it's, you know, it's 100% different from each other, but it's the closest I can get. I'm keeping an eye on her. She's not vaguely reacting, now she is. She's coming to fetch her baby. There she is. The little one is now standing 3 feet from us. If she comes any closer towards us, I'm just going to move off because we're going to escalate a situation that doesn't need to be escalated. He's just playing. Yes, but very big and strong. But you also mustn't learn to do this, of course, because once you do weigh 6 tons, this will be substantially more terrifying than it is now. Look at him. She's fine. She's not even looking at us, you know. Don't be silly. He's tempted to touch us, you know. I don't know what that face planting thing is that they do every so often. I've only ever seen young ones do it. Where they come close up and then they don't know what to do, you don't move away, and so they plant their faces into the dirt, which is bizarre. She's so cool. And she's watching him so carefully. And every time he comes, he behind a bush. All right, everyone, we're going to have to leave, I'm afraid. We're going to have to move from here. And I'm going to have to take a slightly shorter route than I was. No, in fact, we can go up this way. All right, let's go back to Jamie with the sunset. I'm not sure where she is, but maybe, Kirsty, if you can just tell her those lions are on hippo pools, if she's anywhere close by, she might be able to get them. One, sorry, quickly before you go, have you gone? Sleeping. You see the one sleeping on the floor here? Look, there we go. One little elephant snoozing, fast asleep on the floor, exhausted by the day. Completely exhausted. Isn't that awesome? All right, on we go. Let's go across to Jamie.
And we are sitting and watching the sun go down from Impala Plains. I'm just marveling at what a wonderful day it is to be out in the African bush. I am, of course, biased because we've just come from a sighting of a leopard cub. Truly marvelous. Isn't that absolutely beautiful? And then the imposing silhouette of the Drakensberg Mountains running for all the way from the setting sun and continuing south. And continuing south about 1,000 kilometers through South Africa. The Mountains of the Dragon. Woo woo! I hear hyenas. Should we go find them?
Yeah.
Yep, I think so. We may not have won the competition, Dave, but we sure as heck gonna go out with a bang. Let's go find these hyenas. Unfortunately, guys, we are too far to get to those lions. Just in terms of distance, short of throwing off Dave and Chelsea, throwing them off the back of the vehicle and then having to film myself, we won't be able to get there in time and then back across to Fireside Chat. Both Dave and Chelsea look relieved that that was my decision. I don't really think they fancy walking home, battered and bruised, having been launched off due to a bump. Right, hyena, I hear you. They're somewhere, it actually sounds like they're somewhere close to that buffalo kill that the Nkuhumas had Now, I think we've been talking about this, and we got caught in a situation where we had to choose a sighting. We had to choose the mating lions and the female that was with them, or we had to go back to the Nkuhuma, the other two Nkuhumas with their buffalo kill. And we stayed with the mating lions, but apparently when the guys went back to the buffalo kill, it had been snatched by hyenas, which is what we expected to happen. There wasn't all that much left of it. But the hyenas dragged it onto Simbambili, which means that they do have, our clan does have a den site on Simbambili, or most likely they have a den site on Simbambili. Oh, Kirsty, sorry, I turned you right up there. My right ear is now throbbing. It was my fault. There we go. That's a little bit more reasonable. But yes, it looks as though they've got a den somewhere on Simbambili. So Gwen, the new hyena mother, she appears to be keeping herself relatively safe around the Galago shortcut den and away from the other hyena, and I think she's doing that because she's a low-ranking female. And I think the rest of them have moved across towards Simbambili, which means that we only unfortunately ever catch fleeting glimpses of them every now and again when they come back onto Juma. And it's interesting that they chose to move that far west, particularly considering that the Elephant Plains hyena clan is quite a large, not enormous, but apparently is quite a large hyena clan with quite a fearsome reputation. So it's interesting that our hyenas chose to move in that general direction. Alright, and keep our eyes peeled. It sounded like the hyena was calling from somewhere here. Of course, the difficulty being that hyenas don't tend to sit still as night falls, especially if they're busy territorially whooping. They often move about a lot. But let's see if we can't find this hyena for you. And you'll have to forgive me. I meant to do this earlier, but I got distracted by the glorious nature of the sunset, but my microphone, which lives under my hat. Oh, jackal! Never mind. I'll readjust while we look at the jackal. Hello, guys. Oh, it's our side-striped jackal pair. Absolutely awesome. There's one there, and there's one here. There's the male. That's definitely the male. He's much bigger than the female, much stockier. Side-striped jackals. Awesome. I'm so glad they've stuck around. I was hoping they would have. Okay, I'm just going to go backwards a little bit. See if we can't see them from here. I think they're going to... Oh, they're going to go behind that tree. I see them. Thank you, Dave. I saw them. Thank you, Dave. They've just ducked there. There we go. Well done. Well spotted, Dave. Absolutely marvelous. So it seems as though our side-striped jackal pair have established themselves on Impala Plains and Sandy Patch Road, their little territory, a mated pair, and hopefully that means in the not too distant future the possibility of the pitter-patter of little jackal pup paws. Let's try for one last view. While we do, over to James, who's added another species to his list.
There we go, everybody. We've got some Nyala. We can't spend any time here. We have to head towards the fireside chat. So there they are, Nyala cows, young Nyala bull on the right-hand side. And that is that. Let's go back to Jamie and that special dog-like thing.
Dog-like things are... Where are they moving to? just a little bit behind the tree. We're going to get a nice clear view of them up ahead. What a marvelous day. What an absolutely wonderful afternoon. Here we go. Setting out on their evening foraging. The side-striped jackal, female on the left, I think. She looks a little bit smaller than the male on the right. Amazing how wonderfully they've relaxed as well in terms of their comfort level with the presence of human beings and the vehicles. And as I said, I'm really hoping that in the next few months we might get little jackal pups if they den in one of the termite mounds around here. We're not going to try and follow them too closely because we want to keep them with this comfort level with the vehicles. And they seem to be relatively relaxed. We don't want to in any way stress them out. They're busy scent marking. And they are territorial. And they're territorial, so the females will defend a territory against other female jackals, the male against other males, and both of them will play a role in marking their territory. Trot, 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 trot. I wonder where they're off to. Jackal territories are generally not very large, but our jackals have an area that is almost a vacuum of jackal life, in that we didn't have any jackals around this area for a long time. So to start seeing a pair regularly is really, really exciting, because once they get more and more used to us, we'll be able to spend time with them in the same way we do with our leopards, lions and hyenas. And possibly even, we won't be able to go off-road for them or anything like that, but possibly even really get to know them and to sort of observe their behavior on a much more detailed level. Okay, so they're not running from us. They're not showing any signs of running from us. They're just on the move, and I'm going to let them move off and past us and towards Impala Plains. A jackal pair is a wonderful thing. Totally monogamous for life. They mate for life unless one of them dies, obviously. They raise their pups together. They play equal roles in raising the pups, and then the pups actually stick around with their parents to help raise the next generation before they move off and search for mates of their own. Okay, trying to decide whether or not we should follow on. Let's just follow them to the curve of the road, because I think they're going to go off there, and then we will leave them to go about their evening foraging. Oh, they're actually trotting back. Oops, one gone. Where's the other one? Oh, I think they've both moved off the road now. Okay, that's perfect. In that case, we will leave them be. Now, speaking about jackals and jackals' pups, Joyce in New Hampshire. Hello and welcome to the Sunset Safari. I hope you've been enjoying it as much as I have. It's such a wonderful thing that we've got to spend time with these fantastic little animals. How many pups, Joyce? Between 2 to 6, but it's usually around 4. That, I think, is probably the average for this area. But I've seen jackal litters of 5 before, and they can, in theory, go right up to 6. Slightly smaller than the maximum of the other canid species out here. So the wild dog, and the wild dog, of course, is capable, a female is capable of giving birth of up to 20 pups from one adult female, which is phenomenal when you think about it. That's absolutely incredible. Jackals, slightly smaller litter sizes. Now we get both the black-backed and the side-striped jackal. The side-striped is slightly stockier, a little bit taller, slightly larger, but only fractionally than the black-backed jackal. And amazingly, they've evolved to fill essentially the same ecological niche, little fox-like scavengers, but they tend to remain relatively separate from each other. They're found in exactly the same areas. And usually when you've got a lot of side-striped, you have less black-backed, and when you've got a lot of black-backed, you've got less side-striped. Now that's sort of effect that they have on each other's populations. So a truly marvelous way to start winding down our sunset safari, and it's not yet over because we haven't got to the place where the hyena was whooping yet. Yes, absolutely. I think that is a wonderful idea that has come through from Ellen Fowler. Ellen Fowler would like us to send out a 4th of July shout out to all of the Karula and family group members who are watching today. And we're talking about the Facebook group. And Ellen, if it's all right by you, I'd actually like to extend that to all of our regular viewers watching out there. I hope that you've had a marvelous day, whether or not you are from the States or not. But for all of our viewers who've been watching for years, and those of you who've only recently just joined us, I hope you have had a fantastic day. But a special shout out from Ellen, who has been a regular viewer for many, many years and knows all of the animals here exceptionally well, to all of the members of the Karula and Family Facebook group. Right. Hyena was calling from somewhere here, which is right next to where the buffalo kill was. Let us keep our eyes peeled, at the same time keeping an eye on the time. Here we go. Oh, that's a Dacre. Never mind. Sorry, little Dacre. While we look for our spotted hyena, the most unusual of all of the mammal species in terms of their social structure and hierarchy, Bud, in North Carolina, you wanted to know whether there's ever been a recorded case of a male hyena taking over. Lots of tracks here, let's just check carefully. Doesn't look like the buffalo's gone. Sorry, Bud. We'll get back to you in one moment. Buffalo carcass has gone, which is not a surprise. That's pretty much what I expected to have occurred. Lots of hyena tracks. Just look really carefully. Make sure that they're not hiding away somewhere here. They might have decided to hang around in the hope of the odd scrap. The Bud's question concerns whether or not a male hyena has ever taken over and dominated a hyena clan, or indeed any of the females. And the answer is, I have never heard of it happening. I know that clan rails do play an important role in the social structure, but I have never heard of them taking a dominant role over a hyena clan. And it comes down to physiology. There's a vulture up there. That's not the best place I could have put poor Dave. But there we go. A white-backed vulture. No, it's not a white-backed vulture, sorry. I thought it was, it's not. It looks like a tawny eagle. My mistake. Yeah, that's an eagle. Sorry, everybody. I'm sure I saw a vulture earlier. That's definitely not a vulture. In fact, I think that tawny eagle probably feels a little bit insulted. Sorry. Sorry, you're not an eagle. I mean, you're not a vulture, you're an eagle. Looking beautiful in this evening light. Also attracted by the scraps, though, so not a completely disastrous mistake, because there's a good chance that this bird is here also to try and feed off the scraps of the carcass. The eagle family not above scavenging themselves. But back to scavengers and Bud's question, just to finish it off. Physiologically, the male hyena are just that much smaller than a female. Even the smallest female is generally larger than the largest male. So I've never heard of it. Never say never, though, in the animal kingdom. Right. Now, I forgot completely about the competition. My mistake. Sorry, Kirsty, confirm I'm on 20. And James is on 29. And we have 10 minutes. Anything's possible, I guess. Off we go. The underdog is from the start, Dave. I think we're going to lose this one, Dave. I think it's okay. Thank you, Dave. I think it's all right as well. Okay, come. We're going to get all the nocturnal beasties. All nine of them. Oh, dear. Oh, dear. Okay, everybody start looking very, very hard. I think we've lost, but it's okay because I don't know that we could safely say that we lost. We did have a sighting of Shadow and her cub. But really, that's us being thrashed. That's absurd. We've lost by nearly 30%. No. No. Ignominious defeat. Okay, bush baby, let's at least round off the primate sightings. We might not have seen baboons, but we can still see a bush baby. And don't forget, if we find a pangolin, it's 150 points, Dave. No pressure. Now, while we search for the spotted hyena that I know was calling somewhere here, Bradley, you'd like to know about its slightly shyer cousin, the brown hyena, and whether or not we ever see them. Well, Bradley, I haven't seen one on Juma before. I have been fortunate enough to work in areas where they are relatively common, but they don't seem to be too frequently seen up here. Apparently one was seen with Peter Pretorius many years ago. There was much excitement. This was obviously way before my time. The truth is, with the lion concentration and the number of hyenas, spotted hyenas that is, it's not really a suitable environment for them. And that combined with the fact that there's out here, they quite like to den, or they often like to den in rocky outcrops and little what we call koppies. There's not really the most suitable of environments for them. Now, I haven't seen a brown hyena, but it's always a possibility. Never say never, because they do occur here. And I think that one of those should be worth 100 points as well, if we see one. But now we're shifting the goalposts a little bit. Okay, come on, bush baby. I still can't get over the cheek of Shadow's cub. That was absolutely marvelous. She's raised a precocious one. When Shadow went to go and eat, or even just, I think, have a sniff at the kill, her cub hissed at her. And it just goes to show the nature of leopards. They're solitary things. Even with a very tight mother and cub bond, that deep maternal instinct, even then, there is an instinct within them that is, first of all, survival-based, and second of all, they're not social creatures. Although they have been recorded sharing kills, mothers and cubs, plus even occasionally the dominant male of the area. But I must say that was quite an interesting moment when the cub turned around and sort of bared its teeth at mom. And I hope some of you have got some amazing screenshots of that sighting, because it was such glorious light and I'm really looking forward to having a look through some of them when I return to camp after the fireside chat that is almost upon us. And just a quick reminder on the subject of Fireside Chat. Obviously, we attempted to put Fireside Chat on Facebook over the last few weeks, and clearly that didn't work out terribly well for some of you, for a lot of you. Fireside Chat will be in its standard format, so we will be doing it as per normal, so you can stay tuned and we will go straight into Fireside Chat. And I'm sure James is frantically setting up as we speak, along with Viam and Brian and Connor, and putting in all of the work that usually goes into a Fireside Chat. And naturally, of course, I hope you're all prepared to join in, actually, with the song at the end. Well, James, I believe, unless he was lying to me, which I don't think so, but you never know, he might have been lying to me, I believe it is a popular favorite that we all know the words to. Hopefully, we will have many more moments to look forward to with Shadow and her cub. I'm sorry, it's wiped out every other thought from my mind. The first time that I have ever seen that little creature. And she is absolutely marvelous. And definitely nobody could accuse that little cub of being lacking in spirit. And apparently, just so you know, there is a chance we might be fractionally late for Fireside Chat. I am uncertain as to cause, but I'm sure there is... Ah, there's some elephants in quarantine. I'm not sure if those two thoughts are connected, but there are apparently elephants in quarantine. Let's go find them to keep us entertained. Oh, never mind, that's why there was a delay. There were elephants in quarantine. There are no longer elephants in quarantine, in which case I was going to go the other way, but that's okay. We'll go this way. We have equal chances of seeing anything as night starts to descend. Well, you know, they can be forgiven for a late setup due to an elephant obstruction. These things happen. And the nice thing about being in the bush is that whilst certain excuses don't work on your way to the corporate office, I have more than once used the reason that I was stuck behind an elephant or with a lion in the middle of the road. Sorry. A very interesting smell. Trying to work out what that was. That's immediately struck me as something unusual. You've got it too, Dave. I don't know what it is. At first I thought leopard urine, but it's not. It's too smelly, not to put too fine a point on it. I don't know what that is. Interesting. It's not often, to be completely honest, because we spend so much time out here, it's not often that we encounter smells that we can't identify. And now, of course, I've been smelling it too much. I can't smell it at all, as our bodies do. Huh. I don't know what that was. I'm trying to work out what it could be. It's not a plant. It's definitely not a plant. I wonder if it's not a secretion from something like a civet or one of the mustelids or viverrids, like an anal paste, maybe. I don't know. That was unusual. Very strange smell. It smelt a little... I don't know. Can't describe it, actually. Musky, I suppose, is one of the good ways of trying to go about it, but I've never been particularly good at describing smells or tastes. Hehehe. Kirsty goes radio silence. That's how I know things are going terribly wrong. That's okay. We'll keep you entertained as we drive, basically circle the fireside chat, looking for various things and perhaps looking for the owner of that odious scent. There was a bush baby in there, but that's going to be next to impossible for poor Dave. I feel as though we've put poor Dave through enough on this afternoon safari. Looking at ridiculously obscure birds moving very rapidly through the trees. And it was all for nothing, Dave. I know. At least we had a leopard cub. And James, I don't even think James is going to even try and brag in any way. He can't. He wouldn't possibly be silly enough to attempt that, surely. And I'm sure James being James, and James, just by the way, don't tell him I said this, but James is an incredibly kind human being. I actually don't think James is going to gloat at all. Kind and magnanimous. Despite his claims otherwise. The odd beep from Kirsty telling me that things are still delayed and that they have no picture. Most unfortunate, there is a bucky racing off somewhere. I think it's the bucky, yep, it's definitely the bucky. That's Connor, the rally driver. And I'm just circling because I can't actually go anywhere. I can't go much further, otherwise I'll leave James all on his own to manage fireside chat. You know when you really need to find something to say and you've quite literally run out of words and your brain is frozen? That's exactly what's happened to me. Is the moon up yet, Dave? No, we don't have the camera to look at the moon, do we, Dave? And there's no elephants, Dave. Oh no. This is most tragic. And I've run out of words. I've officially run out of words. My family members would be astounded. Now what? Connor is frantically racing to final control, apparently. Never fear, though. I don't think we will be giving you a 5-minute fireside chat. I imagine we will be going over time. At this point, what is it? We're 10-2 now. Right, where should we go next, ladies and gentlemen? We don't really have many options. We'll go round the dam, I guess. Go see what's happening there. And hello to Jonathan, who has mercifully provided me with a question, and I am very, very grateful for that, Jonathan. You're looking at the spotlight in my hand, and you want to know what it is we're looking for. Is it movement? Or reflection, or what is it? The answer is reflection. So it's actually almost easier to sort of, I mean, there's a little bit of skill that you can work at when it comes to spotlighting, but it's actually almost easier to spot animals by night with a spotlight rather than by day, and that's because they have that reflective layer at the back of their eyes called the tapetum lucidum, and that gives them their night vision, their ability to see in the dark. For the herbivores, the diurnal animals, that glow that bounces back at us is relatively dim. That's because they are not hugely active at night. But for animals like the scrub hare, oh, never mind, scrub hare's gone. Sorry. For animals like a scrub hare or a civet or a leopard or a lion, their reflective layer is... it's very bright, it's almost like a hazard light is shining back at you. And there's more tricky things to spot, chameleons for example. Bush babies are a bit trickier. But you get very practiced at spotting things looking back at you in the bush. But we do not shine our spotlight on diurnal animals. we keep that well away from them so as not to if it passes over them. Oh no, what a disaster. Not black screen as well. Poor Kirsty. Sorry everybody. I think I've got... I'm going to try and write it by going back towards quarantine. Long story short, we don't shine spotlights on diurnal animals, and Chelsea has just been a perfect one. She just took a picture. But that's not really as bad. It's sort of mitigated the fact that there is a presenter spotlight just underneath Dave. So, you know. Okay. We've done a huge circuit of... elsewhere.
I'm very, very sorry, everybody. Couple of technical glitches here. The largest of them caused by the largest animals out here, some elephants, that precluded us setting up the fireside chat. So we do apologize for the lateness of our run, but we'll run a little bit over time, and I hope you've got nowhere better to go. Well, I mean, where else could you possibly have that's better to go than here by the fireside in the middle of the African bush? Now, we're most... pleased to welcome and wish all of our American viewers a happy 4th of July, your Independence Day, and as Jamie's pointed out, Independence Day in Rwanda and Philippines as well. So if there are any viewers from Rwanda or the Philippines, it would be wonderful to hear from you. We're now going to go straight into some highlights of the cast. Let's go and have a look at Karula's little babies, George and Charlotte.
Well, everybody, where there is death, there is life, and there is death in the tree there that you can see. And it was made by Karula, the queen. Not found by us. I would love to claim some kind of credit for this. This is entirely the work of Herbert, who's just called us in here, and he's found these two, or these three, beautiful leopards. Isn't that special? Oh, look, she's going up the tree. Look at this. Look. What a clever girl.
Your timing is perfect because look who's making her way down. Oh, oh. Hey, that was pretty graceful. Well done. Oh. Oh, that's so sweet. Little bit of affection there between mom and daughter. Quickly clean away all of that daker that I'm sure she's got everywhere. Yarr, cub pile. George wants to sleep. Charlotte wants to play. Oh, there's mom's tail. And now mom is thinking about having a little bit of a late afternoon snack.
So a very small highlights package of a quite astonishing number of sightings that we've had of Karula and little George and Charlotte. Now to join me by the fireside to talk about these things, the only lady of our team, the magnificent and elegant Jamie Patterson.
What a fantastic introduction.
Yes, I think it was a rather fantastic introduction. I'm also having microphone troubles. Oh, good, okay. Can you hear us?
Hello.
Look at us hugging everybody.
Hi.
Come and sit. Yes, because we haven't seen each other for at least 2.5 hours, have we,
exactly.
Jamie?
Mm. And so much has happened in those
marvelous.
Two and
you've
a half.
Got no audio.
I've got no audio.
Yeah, but you have a busby hanging from the front of your
yes, but the clip is
your
stuck.
Body.
The clip is stuck, James. And so,
yes.
And so things have all gone
well,
very
it's
wrong.
Well, picking up here, I'm afraid.
Things have all gone very wrong.
Anyway, hang on a second. Let me sort this out. The elephants have put paid to given us real trouble. I'm going to sort it out by putting this microphone between us. We're going to just manage. The way we know how best, I don't know how that is. Hold on, everybody. Hold on. Oh, you're going to hear rattling. Well, I don't know that you can help me. Okay.
Oh, marvellous.
Can you hear us both now?
Hi.
There we are.
All right.
Marvellous, well done. Now, Jamie, we've just watched the Karula clip. You've had a little bit of time since you've been back from leave. Have you enjoyed your time with George and Charlotte?
I have absolutely enjoyed my time with Karula's two cubs. The
sorry,
male and
with
female
cubs.
With Karula's young cubs.
Oh,
yes.
You mean George and Charlotte?
Karula's young cubs are absolutely marvellous. Unofficially, George and Charlotte are absolutely wonderful. They have grown tremendously since I last saw them, and they were terribly entertaining when I did see them.
And why don't you like the names?
I'm not entirely sure. I feel they are African enough.
Mm, yeah. Well, that's a debate perhaps for another time.
Perhaps.
Now, I made the comment the other day that I didn't think they played very much, and I didn't think that this was unusual, because they are obviously going to grow into very solitary animals. Then Andrew shot a really nice sort of video of the cubs having a little bit of a play, and you saw them having a bit of a play.
Yep.
In your experience, do they play less than lion cubs?
Yes. From what I've seen of leopard cubs, yes, they play with their mother a lot.
Mm.
But I haven't... of course they get to play with each other. They're little moving objects, and leopards like to hunt little moving objects, including siblings and mom's tail. But lion cubs play almost continue, unless they're sleeping or feeding, they play almost constantly. Mm.
And I think that's completely normal. I think there are a few people that thought when I made the comment that it was that I thought it was unusual. I don't. I just think it's interesting that, you know, we know that cats like to play. You've got house cats at home that sometimes like to play. But these leopards don't like to play with each other a huge amount. That's not to say they won't, but they do it less perhaps than at other times. Now, the other babies we've been seeing, of course, are the two very brand new little hyenas. Have a look at this.
Hey girl, you're beautiful, but we did actually come to see your cubs as well, and you put yourself... Oh, there we go. Hello. Oh my word, they've grown so much. Just hear them squealing. Hello. Ah. Oh. I knew that there were two, but this is the first time I've seen them both together. And she just looks the picture of contentment. Ooh. And that was a very conclusive victory that we just saw there.
One.
Oh, wasn't that absolutely incredible? It was such a treat because it's the first time I had been back to the hyena den since I was on leave. And I just took a chance because there were tracks wandering up and down Gallagher Shortcut, and I thought I'd just poke my nose in, as we often do when we are driving past any of the known hyena den sites. And there she was, with two little squabbling babies, which was, I think, the most fascinating part of that entire sighting.
Just talk us through that. I mean, one very clearly dominated the other one, didn't it?
That was what it looked like, and what I noticed, and I mean, perhaps on reflection it wasn't as clear as I thought it was, but there seems to be a size difference, quite a clear size difference in my mind, between the one that started feeding initially, the bolder one, and the one that was trying to get in to feed. And I mean, there was space for both of them. It was just really interesting behavior between the two. And eventually the one, as you saw in that clip, was pushed back into the den itself.
Do you think that's a function of the fact that one's male and female, they're different sexes, or do you think one has just dominated the other and through the course of extra nutrition become larger?
I don't know. I'm sorry.
Nor do I.
Because, I mean, I'm probably going to say something like, well, I think it means that they're both female because they're squabbling, because males automatically take a subservient role. And then I'm going to prove spectacularly wrong, because we actually don't know everything there is to know about hyenas. Yeah. So I don't know what the reason is. There's clearly one dominant, one less dominant, whether that means they're both females or one male, one female. Maybe also... One female, one male.
And quite interesting also that it's a subdominant mother.
Yes.
And yet the cubs are still having very severe squabbling matches with each other.
Yeah.
Which I think is quite interesting. All right, well, that was the hyenas. Now, we haven't seen any cubs yet, but the makings of some cubs we saw yesterday. Take a look at this.
We're going to mate again. He's interested. I think she just wants to go say hello to her other pride mate. Interesting. That's very interesting. Let's see if she phlegm and grimaces. Yes. How fascinating is that? Here we go, she's gonna mate again. Oh, is she? He's certainly hopeful. Oh no, I'm sorry, buddy. Your affections have been surpassed. Interesting. I mean, this is pure hormonal confusion.
I don't know really what to say about that other than, wow. It's an interesting thing, and I mean, we could discuss it all night long. What's your take?
I think it's just hormones. I think you've got an estrus female and a lactating female. So the post-pregnancy hormones plus the estrus hormones, so the heat hormones. And I think it just resulted in that female getting... I said confused. You asked me why I said confused, and I said just because she was mating with a female... It's not dominance, that I will say. I don't think, you know, you often get the mock mounting with males.
Males, yeah.
Yeah, I don't think that's a dominance display at all. But you get it with female dogs. I've seen females do that a lot.
Me too.
So I don't
But is that dominance, do you think?
No, I don't know. Again, I'm not entirely sure about the answer to this question. It's the first time I've ever seen that situation play out. And it was absolutely fascinating because it went right down to the biting of the back of the neck, which is unique.
My take on it, and I might be totally wrong here, is that she sniffed the urine and she did the phlegm and grimace, so she was testing the urine. Now, lionesses have a certain amount of testosterone in their bodies. Yep. She's a biggish lioness. I mean, she's not massive, but she's tall, and she probably might therefore carry a bit more testosterone than the other lionesses. And because she's wired in a certain way, that the pheromone she's picking up from the urine may well just trigger a response because her testosterone levels might, or some other male hormone, androgen perhaps, or some other androgen type hormone maybe sort of triggered a response. I don't know.
That's a very cool idea. I have absolutely no explanation as to what that is. I think that is a very good theory.
Well, thank you. That's very kind of you from you. That's high praise indeed.
Absolutely.
Now, the competition today, the 4th of July competition for the Americans, the Rwandans and the Filipinos, was won by me today. 29 points for me, 20 for Jamie. I am, however...
Are you going to brag, James?
No, I'm not. I think I'm actually going to say that because you had a leopard and cub, and if you can bring yourself to say... the name that I have given the cub, if you can bring yourself to say that, I'm going to give you an extra 10 points and you will then win. But you're going to have to say what her name is.
And I shall... Oh no, this is the worst.
Yes? What was her name?
I'm so torn between not wanting to concede this and also wanting to win.
It was a leopard cub. I mean, you probably do deserve to win.
It was a leopard cub.
And what was its name, Jamie?
James the Closet Royalist has nicknamed unofficially...
No, you can't say that. Don't say unofficially. Yeah?
James has named Shadow's cub Zara.
There we go. Jamie wins the 4th of July show, everybody. And for you, a very short, American song for you. It's a wonderful American song, and we all know it. And Jamie, I hope that you'll join me in the chorus if we still have time. A long, long time ago, I can still remember when that music used to make me smile. And I knew if I had a chance, I could make those people dance, and maybe they'd be happy for a while. But February, in this case July, made me shiver with every paper I deliver. Bad news on the doorstep, I couldn't take one more step. Oh, I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride, but you know something touched me deep inside the day the music died. And they were singing bye-bye, Miss American, bye. Told my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Them good old boys are drinking whiskey and rye, singing, this'll be the day that I die. This'll be the day that I die.